This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Sports Files is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Ni hao! Tonight, we say hello to Chinese basketball. So Bob Weiss has been the head coach of four different NBA teams. You'd think he would have seen everything. But then he took the job as head coach of the Brave Dragons, a Chinese basketball team, and he was off on the adventure or misadventure of a lifetime. But before I get to the subject of this show, let me say some nice words about marriage. Yes, marriage, because it's only because of marriage that Weiss is on tonight's show. He married a Memphian, Tracy, and he's in town visiting his in-laws. We get a lot of interesting visitors that way. Joe Theismann spends time in Memphis because he married a Memphian. Same with Peyton Manning. Same with Tim Howard, the goalkeeper for the U.S. national soccer team. It's a twist on that old saying. If you can't beat him, join him in holy matrimony. So Weiss was gracious enough to stop by to talk about his coaching adventures in China, which were captured in a new book by Jim Yardley called Brave Dragons, a Chinese basketball team, an American coach, and two cultures clashing. The really interesting part is that last bit, by the way, the part about two cultures clashing. Basketball is huge in China, but it also clashes with the Chinese culture in a fundamental way. Basketball, almost by necessity, requires spontaneous creativity. China, almost by necessity, represses, or at the very least doesn't value, spontaneous creativity. It made for an interesting season, which in turn made for an interesting book. We'll talk to Bob Weiss about it coming up next. As promised, joined now by Bob Weiss, longtime NBA coach, and first of all, you had the good sense to marry a Memphian. And your chief credential, particularly for being here, you had the good sense to marry a Memphian.
Well, I always wanted to see Memphis, so when I had the chance, I married one, yeah, which is the primary reason, I guess.
So, Tracy, so here is the here's the book, Brave Dragons, a Chinese basketball, I don't know where I hold this up to whatever, Brave Dragons, which is about the year, you've now spent another year in China.
Yes.
Where, by the way, you did encounter our old friend, Bonzi Wells. We'll get to that in a minute.
Okay.
But tell me briefly, how did you come to be coaching a Chinese basketball team?
Well, it was a perfect storm, probably. We were living in Seattle. I was working with Seattle, and which was hijacked by the Oklahoma team.
Right.
By Oklahoma.
It's doing okay now, actually.
Yeah, they're really doing, yeah.
They're doing okay.
It's still hard to cheer for them, though. There's only one player left from when I was there, and that was Nick Collison.
Nick Collison was there when
Nick
you were there.
Right. Was there. But they were leaving town, and so my wife said, both our children are off to school now, to college. We're empty nesters. We've always talked about maybe sometime in the future going overseas to coach and and live. And she said, we ought to look into that. And I said, well, yeah, but she was thinking France, Italy, you know, the leagues over there. And so I called an agent, a guy named Warren Legarry, who had ties over there. And he called me back and said that, you know, he said, Europe's not as hot as it used to be for American coaches, but China is really hot right now, and they're paying very good money. So I said, he said, would you be interested? I said, well, let's explore everything. So we explored it. And so he called me back and said, yeah, they want you. You know, the bad news is they want you in like 2 weeks. I don't even have a passport, right? And so we thought about it a little bit, and we decided to go over there. And it turned out to be a tremendous experience.
It's remarkable. Initially, you were hired as a consultant. You learned when you landed in Beijing. I was actually at the Olympics in Beijing, and you were going to go to the Olympics.
We were in Beijing.
You were
going to
go, and you were there for about an hour before you learned that you were no longer a consultant. You were the head coach of this team, which was I would say the Charlotte Bobcats, maybe of the. I mean, the, yeah, the yeah of the league of the Chinese.
Well, they had won five games. They played, I think, 30 games that season. They it flops around. They play 50. They play 30, depending on what is going on in the city.
So by way of backdrop, how big is basketball in China?
Well, it's probably the biggest team sport over there. But compared to the United States, it's not that big. They would they have smaller arenas. They draw maybe 5,000 or so. They love basketball. They especially if there's a Chinese player, they would televise all of Houston's games.
Right.
In China.
I was struck by how many just public parks there are with people with pickup game. I mean, all the time in Beijing, and I don't know what that was. Now, this city where you were, this was not Beijing.
No, we were kind of in the back country. We were in a place called Taiyuan, and I think some of the players coming over there thought they were going to Taiwan, and I think it hit me that way for a minute. I said, where am I going? And we had no idea where this was. It's about 275 miles southeast of Beijing. It's in the coal country and steel country, and so it's very, you know, the skies, you see the stars maybe 3 nights a year.
Really?
Yeah,
it's bad.
The pollution is not too good, and it's when you're in Beijing, you see a lot of American signs, or if you're in Shanghai and of course Hong Kong, but if you're in these other cities, you are completely illiterate. There's no English on the signs, and of course you don't speak the language. And
there was an early story in the book of you had a card to make phone calls, and it would run out of minutes. And one of your early messages to Tracy, your wife, was, do not, when we're running out of minutes, do not come over here. Was that at least as recorded?
That was like after my first one or two nights over there. yes, in my contract, it was interesting. I had this luxury apartment with a 24-hour access to a driver.
Sounds lovely.
I envisioned a guy with a little suit and a town car, which turned out to be a van with another Mr. Wong driving. And so I get to this apartment that first night, and I look up on the thing at the top, says Howard Johnson's, and we go in. There's no lobby, it's just a reception area, and it was basically apartments, more apartments than it was, I think, a hotel. And so I go up to my room, and I go in there, and it's a motel room with a small, small sink as you walk in on the left with the... And that was it. And the bathrooms over there are very different. I walk in the bathroom, it's probably about 6 by 8. It's linoleum on the floor everywhere.
Right.
There's a shower head, there's a toilet, and there's a sink. And there's no shower curtain, nothing. The whole bathroom
is
the shower.
You just close the door and
Turn on the shower. Everything in the bathroom that's going to be in there is wet. And... But I turned on this particular shower, and it had a big round head coming dead, out of the top of the ceiling, and 3/4 of the water was going north and hitting the hitting the ceiling, and then it would come back down, of course, and hit you a little bit. But I go in, I look at that, I'm thinking, I can't bring Tracy over here into this. Are you kidding me? So that's why I
it
said
it. Sounds don't. Like through the course of the book, it was she had particularly a marvelous adventure.
We both did. But we moved out of that hotel.
You moved out of that hotel. Okay, tell me about Boss Wong, who is one of the real characters, is the Michael Heisley of this book, only more impetuous, more demanding, more off the charts.
More into it, yeah. I describe him as Mark Cuban on steroids.
Right.
He grew up, he's a very interesting character, and he grew up in rural China during a time that he's in his early 60s at that time, so he's about 65 or so now. He was very poor. He worked tremendously long hours just to survive. China was going through a famine at the time. Mm-hmm. His family actually ate tree bark at times, and just things in the dirt to have something in their stomach and survive. Then he had a stint in the Red Guard as he came up. He went through the Mao Revolution, the culture, and you know, a lot of interesting times over there, which I don't know all the details of what happened then, but he was in it. And he married a woman that was, her father was in the Communist Party quite high up. And then when the economic thing turned around.
And capitalism.
Yep, capitalism blossomed there. He looked out and saw that, you know, people are going to have to be moving around now because they're going to have jobs here and there and they can go where they want, do what they want. So he bought a bus, a couple buses, and he was able to get loans from the government because of his ties. Then he decided that there were goods being transported, so he bought a couple trucks, and then he started hauling steel. And this all grew. Then he decided, you know, the people that own the steel mills are making more money than the
trucks.
So he borrows more money and buys steel mills. And that's how he made his money, I think.
One of the richer men in China at that point. There's obviously billionaires. And yet, sort of a lunatic. And he, you were an active ego in many ways for him. The first NBA head coach to come to China. You had never met him. Is that
No, never met him. And he, you know, during this period of, I think when he got a little older, he developed a liking to basketball and organized leagues in
his
factories
Jordan.
And things like that, yeah, and watched American television and really considered himself the, you know, aficionado of basketball because he watched so many NBA games. And I think that's one of the reasons he fired so many coaches is because he fired one coach after one game. He goes out and he hires a national coach from Korea.
Right.
Coached, you know, he had the credentials to coach a national team.
Right.
Well, he practiced with them for a couple months. Then the season started, and he fired him after the first game. And I know exactly what happened, although nobody's ever told me about it. As I know that Boz Wong made a recommendation on a substitution that this guy didn't do. And since they lost, poof, you're out of here. Because he wants that
he
control.
He made recommendations on substitutions to you?
No, he makes
not to you.
Orders. But to me, there were recommendations.
He sat on
what
the bench.
Would happen?
He sat on the
that
bench.
He would be on the
and
bench.
He had a mysterious
he might
woman
start
who...
out in the crowd over there, and then he'd move a little closer and a little closer before you know it, he's sitting on the bench. Or most of the time, he starts out on the bench. But
he had a mistress, or at least as described in the book,
female assistant.
She sat on the bench.
She was on the bench. And they have these rules about how many people can sit on the bench.
And he just flouted them.
So, well, or he gives himself the title of, you know, executive assistant or something like that. But
so what was the level of basketball?
The level of basketball is, well, it's probably easiest to understand in that guys that just are borderline making an NBA will average between 25 and 30 over there.
I got you.
So it's below the elite. With two Americans, you're going to have two Americans on each team, or foreigners. And with those two players, with two guys that are almost NBA caliber or ex-NBA like Marbury and Bonzi, they would probably be as good as maybe a Final Four team, really good teams.
Right.
But most of the teams are not on that
level. I should say, by the way, that after you left, subsequent seasons, Boss Wong is the person who did bring Stephon Marbury over there. So this, he clearly has a love of American basketball. The guts of the book are really about this conflict that between Boss Wong loved the American style and Jordan and creativity. And all the things that we associate with basketball, and yet the Chinese culture seems to lend itself towards, and certainly style of basketball, towards constant drilling, constant sprints, not much in the way of creativity. And so, and I'm just setting it up here. You were brought over to be the coach, but very quickly, because you are don't believe in the Chinese way of basketball. You were sort of replaced as head coach, pushed aside, an assistant took over, and then you were. Tell me about that fundamental conflict.
Well, you know, going back to the original when I was first getting the job, they said they wanted me to coach and bring on a Chinese coach, mentor him into how to coach the American way. And But then as the discussions got going, they said, well, you'll be a consultant. And I think that was for a name only because of the pride of, okay, mm-hmm. we have a Chinese. But it was all messed up. So at one point, like you said, I thought I was going to be there as a consultant, so which is fine. We just want to go over and do this. We don't care. And I wasn't really going. I've been a head coach. I didn't really care that much. So it was actually a little different than finding out in the airport. I did find out I was going to have to coach immediately in the airport. Right. I did, but I thought I was going to be the head coach because I asked a gentleman named Bruce O'Neill who goes over there and runs basketball academies right. over here, and he corresponds with the Chinese all the time. So I said, look, as a consultant, am I going to have to wear a suit? Am I even going to, as a consultant, will I have right. to wear a suit? Because I asked him what they wore over there. He said, yeah, they're going to wear suits this year, but most Chinese coaches only have one, so don't worry too much. So that's when I found out I was going to be the head coach. I said, well, I'm going to be a consultant. Do I need it? He said, no. He said, you're going to be the head coach. So I said, okay.
For my suit.
So, you know, so then my plan was I wanted to go over, watch practice for like 3 days, get a feel, and then I'd start taking over. So I found out when I landed that Boss Wong fired the head coach that day. And I had 2 days starting tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock.
Right.
So, yeah, I'm thrown right into the fire there.
And yet,
I don't know if I answered your
question.
And
then very quickly, though, you did not do it the Chinese way.
Well,
and so you were supplanted.
Right. So what happened was, you know, I start coaching like we coach and doing the things we do. And he had also brought in, Leo Teal wasn't there yet at the time. But he brought in another older coach, probably in his 70s, to assist me and discipline the players. And I think what he really did was he was there to report to Boss Wong what I was doing.
Right.
And I think a lot of his information that Boss Wong got was from this coach
right.
and who didn't maybe approve of
your methods.
The American way of coaching. And what else would happen was we'd have scrimmage games. So in the scrimmage games, like I remember the first time I was up, standing up, and I had heard how much Boss Wong wanted to, you know, be involved and do things. So I'm standing up, the game's going on, and my interpreter walks up and he says, you think we need another shooter out there? And I said, who does he want, Joe? And I was right. That was where it was coming from. And he said, well, they think, yeah. And so when that happened, I would either say, yeah, we can use him, or no, or
right.
not yet.
Right.
So he go back and he talked to him. So he didn't have this immediate control, and which was what he liked, because when he said, okay, I think we'll have Coach Weiss run the practices now and we'll have Leo Tia coach. Then Leo Tia joined us, who was a younger coach, who never had coached. He'd been an assistant. But so when Leo Tia, he said, I want him to coach in the game. So when Leo Tia was, I felt so sorry for this guy, because he'd be sitting here coaching and Boss Wong would be right here and he would be in his ear the entire time. And when he said, let's do this, it was immediate. So all of a sudden,
right.
Boss Wong's grip was immediate
tight.
On the team. And so they said they wanted to have him coach until the season started, then they let me coach again. And when the season started, he stayed with Leo Tia because he wanted to more control. And so he stayed that way until we brought Bonzi over. And so, yeah, these poor kids, they'd be under one system and then they'd be under a completely different system. And
I want to ask, the Bonzi thing, Bonzi Wells, of course, is an old friend of ours here in Memphis. He was banned, actually, from coming to FedEx Forum by Mike Fratello. You can imagine how that went, how the Mike Fratello, well, you probably know Mike, so talk to Mike about how that went. That didn't go well, down too well. All of a sudden, he thought he was going to Taiwan, evidently. He was, according to the book, he was one of the people, he'd looked up Taiwan, said, this is going to be great. And he lands there, not with your approval. You had another American player who was playing very well.
Yeah.
Replaced. It did not.
I had no idea. I mean, they didn't even ask me. Early in training camp, they said, what about Bonzi Wells? And I said, I'll give him a call if you want. But I wasn't excited about Bonzi being on the team. Because I didn't think he'd fit in. And I liked Dante, who was playing well at the time.
Brilliant.
So I said, I'll give him a call. So I called, and Bonzi called me back, and we finally got together. I said, I heard you're interested in playing in China. He says, well, not really. He says, my agent's looking into me playing in Europe. I said, oh, okay, so I got it wrong. Somebody told me that you were interested in playing over here. I said, if you change your mind and you do want to come over here, give me a call, and I'll tell you what everything is like so you don't get hit in the side of the head with this. And he said, yeah, that'd be fine. So then I never hear from him again. So now we're a third of the way into the season, and a little bit before that, I start hearing rumors about Bonzi Wells, and I'm thinking, well, this is old stuff recirculating. And because I thought, surely he would at least ask my opinion on this thing. Right. If we got to make a drastic change like that. And we're doing phenomenally well right. at the time. We're like in the right. top 10.
We have about 3 minutes left.
Okay.
Bonzi comes.
We have to cut Dante. And Bonzi didn't really fit in.
He took 46 shots the first night.
Well, he played well. He played okay. He could score. But he didn't fit in with the Chinese players. He didn't fit in. He didn't buy the culture. He was in a room.
And he left as fast as he came. Just disappeared.
Well, no. 15 games later, he went home on the New Year's break and then was slow getting back. So and we weren't doing any better than we had without him. So the boss said, let's not bring him back.
Let me ask you this. Having seen what you've seen about it, obviously there was a lot with Jeremy Lin, not Chinese, but at least Asian player. Can China produce great basketball players, or is the system so sort of regimented that the creativity can't come out of the Chinese system?
Well, I think in the system they have, it's difficult. You know, you're going to get a couple super talents that can make it, like the two that did, but including Yao Ming. But the problem with the system is it's too restrictive. And, you know, Jeremy Lin would not have been the player he is had he been brought up in China instead of being, you know, playing American basketball and just learning creativity. And the other thing they do is they probably work too hard, which is a result of, you know, you don't know how hard it was for Boss Wong to survive right. coming up. So they have this tremendous work ethic, and now they expect their players
to work as hard as they did,
and their players burn out by 30. 30 is an old for a Chinese player over there. And here they're guys play until they're almost 40, some of them.
Do you believe in leaving basketball for a minute? If you could buy stock in China, the country, what did you come away thinking?
Well, I don't know if I'd buy stock in it. I just don't know the finances that well. It's just an amazingly different country being under communism. I mean, if they want to build a highway, those houses are down immediately,
right.
and the highway goes up. Right. But it's still very difficult. It can be a very, very difficult way of life for a lot of people
over there, but you went back for 1 year, coached for a different team. Would you go back again?
Yes, we go back. We had great experiences both times.
All right.
China is definitely changing with the computers, and even though they restrict a lot of things over there, things sink through, and so things are right. changing. Although there's people in their 20s over there that think Tiananmen Square didn't really happen.
Thank you very much. The book is Brave Dragons, A Chinese Basketball Team, An American Coach, and Two Cultures Clashing. Bob, thank you very much. Who's going to win the NBA Finals?
I don't know. There's three great teams that are going to be in it. I think Miami's going to be in it, and who knows who's going to be in between San Antonio and the Thunder.
Thank you very much.
Okay,
I appreciate it. I'll be back with the wrap after one question.
Pat is doing great. Talked to her this morning, as a matter of fact, and she's excited about her new role, and we're excited to have her in that role. She's a terrific person, first and foremost. Terrific person, terrific mom, and what she accomplished in the sport of basketball is unparalleled. You know, Holly did a fantastic job this year in a very unusual environment, very unique in its nature, and she handled it extremely well. Not only the game action, which everybody watched, but just behind the scenes. So Holly's ready. Holly's certainly not intimidated by this environment. She's excited by it.
We don't have a word for the opposite of loneliness, but if we did, I would say that's what I want in life. That sentence was written by a woman named Marina Keegan, who recently graduated from Yale and wrote a piece about what she was going to miss about college. It's not quite love, and it's not quite community, she wrote. It's just this feeling that there are people, an abundance of people, who are in this together, who are on your team. Keegan's column is making the rounds of the internet these days because, tragically, she was killed in an auto accident Saturday. And no, this has nothing to do with sports, but I thought I'd mention it just the same. I may even read it to my kids, because it says something about impermanence and fragility. It says something about what matters and what does not. What we have to remember is that we can still do anything, Keegan wrote. We can change our minds. We can start over, get a post back, or try writing for the first time. The notion that it's too late to do anything is almost comical. We can't, we must not lose this sense of possibility because, in the end, it's all we have. And that's it for Sports Files this week. You can write the show at sportsfiles@wkno.org. To watch the show online, go to wkno.org and click on KNO Tonight. Until next week, live the life you want to live.